How many of you using xpath? Almost everyone. So do you guys face problem writing relative xpath on a daily basis, writing robust xpath? Okay. So let's talk here. Let's see one scenario here to correlate this selectors problem on a daily basis. So if we have to get the address of any place, let's say without Google Map, how we used to get the address of any place? We will be roaming here and there, looking for someone who can help with the address of that location, isn't it? If you don't have Google Map. So yesterday when I was coming here for this conference, so I reached at the gate and I was not sure like where is the conference hall. I asked one guy, where is the conference hall? He told me, sir, just go straight, take first right and then second right, and there it is. So I reached this, and that's how I reached conference hall and was attending all the conferences all the day. But what if next day one more cross has been introduced in between? So now this conference hall will not be on the second cross, it will be on the third cross. So as we can see here, there are like 1 1 2 1 1 2 3, something like indexes are there. So this is like getting the address of any place which is something like absolute address, which could be changed. Like the probability of changing that this address will is very high. So in this case, let's say tomorrow I will also have to update my memory that now conference hall is in the third cross, and that guy who has helped me, he will also have to update his database that now it's in third cross, it's not in the second cross anymore. So similar situation we have, similar kind of problem we have in our UI. So to perform like talk here, to perform any action here in the conference hall, first I need the address of this place. Then I have to move my control, like I will have to be here, and then I can give the talk. So similarly in the UI, if we have to enter the email address on this email box, what all three things we need? First, we need the address of this email node, then we'll have to move our control over there, and then we can enter the email address over there. So how we are doing it today? Either we are writing it manually or using the dev tools, right? So let me show you. Let's see here, using Chrome dev tools, how we get it. Just right click and copy xpath. But if we see here, we have copied the xpath, but so far we haven't seen the value of the xpath, what it is, whether this is relative or the absolute one. Let's paste it here. So as we can see here, it has the indexes 1 2, something like that. So chances are very high that it will change next time if any feature goes or any node comes in between, so that like there will be like multiple locators will be there which we have in our script. So all will respect to this will have to change all of them, because all will get all will update with the indexes, or else we will be writing our own relative xpath, robust one, respect to the parent and all. How ChroPath solves this problem? Let's see with ChroPath. You just click on that DOM node or inspect the element, it will give you the relative xpath, and copy button is there. Just in a single click, you got the relative xpath. Let's paste it here, which doesn't have any indexes, and we can directly use it in our script. ChroPath helps generating relative xpath, absolute xpath, and CSS selectors. Sometime back, like firepath and firebug has been deprecated in the new version of Firefox. So I was facing problem like while writing the script on Firefox, was not able to, like, first we have to verify it on Chrome, get the locators from the Chrome, and then use it for Firefox. So from there I thought we'll add in support for Firefox as well. So now Chrome, ChroPath is supporting on Firefox and Chrome both. So like so far everybody must be thinking like why we should use ChroPath, like while we can write our own xpath just by looking at the DOM, it won't be like looking at the DOM, getting the tag and attribute, unique attribute, we can write simply. So why to add one more add-on on our browser, and then why should we go for this? So let's see here one live demo. Let's see here how it helps us on a daily basis. So here we have two test cases. One is without ChroPath, one is with ChroPath. So if we have to enter the email address on the email box, is it not visible? Okay. Anyways, so what I'm trying to hear is like on a daily basis we won't be changing the framework, we won't be adding the framework level changes. We just be adding the like test cases or writing the script. So just to write this driver dot find element and by dot xpath and then dot send keys, it won't take much time. Now most of our time used to go in writing the locators. So if you see here, this much writing the command for sending the keys, sending the address, email address on the box, it has not taken much time. Now where we used to spend our most of the time in script. So this is where like if we have to write the email address xpath, so how we will be doing it today? So as we all know, like we use the developer dev tools, Chrome dev tools here. So how do we write it today? So if we have to write the address relative xpath for this email box, what we will do, we'll inspect this element, and then from here we'll be looking at the this node, like input name, and we will be thinking in mind somewhere back that which could be the unique attribute here, so that we can use it in our script. So how do we do that? So let me start the timer here so that we can see how much time we are spending. Okay, so just start the timer, come back here. Here if I have to write, so we'll be writing like double forward slash input a at the rate name is equal to, let's say email, I'm thinking that this could be the unique, but here we can see it's showing 1 of 5, so it's not the unique one. Then we will go for the like either some other attribute or we'll go for the parent one. So let's we'll go for the parent one. There are multiple approaches to write the relative xpath, but this is the like which we have seen mostly people using it. So we'll go with this approach, but still it's showing 1 of 5. We'll go with one more parent. Still it is 1 of 5. Let me go with one more parent. There are other locators as well, like ID, class, if they are unique. So now we got 1 of 1. So this we can use. Let me stop the timer here. So it has taken me 1 minute 3 seconds. So let's assume I was doing here and there, it might have taken 15 to 20 seconds more. But there are like easy locators as well. This might be the little tougher one, so it has taken 1 minute time. But if ID and class are unique, then we can of course directly go with that, but we have to write the locators for which we don't have unique. So here it has taken 1 minute 3 seconds. Let me paste it in the script and come back here. Now similar thing we'll see with the help of ChroPath. Let me open ChroPath. here. So let's start the timer for ChroPath as well, and we'll see how much time it will take with the ChroPath. Start. To get the relative xpath with the help of ChroPath, we just have to click on this node. Just click on this node. It has generated the relative xpath here, and click on copy button. We can stop the timer here. We'll go back to the script and we can paste it here. So whatever we have written manually, we got it with the help of ChroPath. And we can see here how much time we have saved it. Though I was also explaining same thing for the ChroPath, like how does it work. And as we can see, at least around 30 to 40 seconds you will save just for one locators. This is when we are generating the xpath or selectors. Similarly, it also helps while debugging the reports. So most of the time, how are what kind of errors we used to get in UI automation reports? Anyone? Like what kind of exception we used to get a lot, like more frequently? Anyone? No such element, or timeout error, or stale element, something like that. So always, what is our first approach? We used to go for like whether that element is present or not, whether it is our script bug or actual UI bug. So first of all, we'll go and verify, like looking for that element, whether this is still present in the UI or not. So let me show you here how we do it today, like without ChroPath. So let's say here in Myntra.com, for some, let me write some random xpath double forward slash H3. So here you can see, so double forward slash H3, as soon as I typed it here, it is scrolled to the window and highlighted that element and highlighted in the DOM. Now there are five matching nodes, but we don't know which are all those five nodes. And now it's also not highlighting that there in the UI as well. So we cannot figure it out which is that one. As soon as you blink your eyes, it's gone from there in the UI. And here in the node, in the dev tools, we don't know which all five nodes will have to press enter or scroll up and down to get all those five nodes. So this is like juggling here and there and putting your head like which are all those fives. Let me show you similar scenario with ChroPath. Double forward slash H3. Enter. It's giving all five matching nodes in one tab itself and highlighting all those five elements in the UI. And as soon as you press enter, it will scroll those all elements to the viewable area. So here you have all five matching nodes extracted here. And as we can see here, like it has added attributes xpath 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So we know that this is the first matching node, this is the second matching node, this third one, 4, 5. And as soon as you scroll on top of, mouse over on top of them, the element will come into viewable area. So we need not to worry about like where is that element, is there somewhere hidden on the top or bottom or in the middle. It will scroll for you and you will be easily getting to know that this is the element for which I was looking for. So if I would have started the timer here as well, we could have seen like here also we are saving at least just for one element around 30 to 40 seconds of time. And that's how here it is, that's how it helps a lot. And ChroPath also helps in generating absolute xpath, CSS selectors. So you can get the all three and verify here xpath and CSS selector both. So this is why ChroPath. Now here is the trust and the motivation and inspiration which I got from the which motivates me to work on this project. Currently more than 40,000 developers are using in 116 countries and solving the problems of writing robust and relative xpaths and selectors. Want to install it? It's very easy. Just search for ChroPath for Chrome. Open first link and click on add to Chrome, and it's completely free. You can add it and use it. If you want it for Firefox, it's available there as well. Just search for ChroPath for Firefox, and it's very easy to add it there as well. Just open first link and click on add to Firefox. It will add to your browser and you can use it. So now it has solved your solves our problem, and we have seen like it's solving the problem of xpath and selectors. What next in ChroPath? What could be the next in ChroPath? It's already we are already verifying and generating the selectors. Any guess? Sorry? Yes. Yes, yes. Yeah, so it's yes, IDs are like if ID is there, it will be giving you that with that tag name and at the rate ID attribute, and that you can use. Of course, if ID is there, we need not to go there. Yeah.
I'm assuming that you are using the parent structure to always find the unique path.
Yes.
But there are multiple ways that you could traverse
yes.
the entire path. Right?
Yes.
So you might find actually a sibling which is more unique.
Yes.
And maybe your parent traversal gives you probably 4 or 5 levels
yes.
of traversal.
Yes.
Right? So that's one thing that
exactly. Yeah. Exactly. So here it is, ChroPath 3.0 with a complete new UI, which in the single page itself you will get all the relative xpath, absolute xpath and CSS selectors. And selectors tab you need not to change from xpath to CSS. And what he mentioned, here it is. What we are currently getting from ChroPath 2.0 is that from the child till like 3-4 parents we were traversing, and this is what we are gonna get from ChroPath 3.0. So directly it will be looking whichever will be the unique parent, directly from there it will jump to the child one. It will not be like we will not be having all those levels. Thank you. I can take the questions. Any query, any feedback would be help. Love to help you. I will be here.
How will you determine which would be the right selector for a given element in a page?
So like if ID and X class is there, those are unique. So it will immediately will write the X path with ID. So you can directly use that ID value. Okay. If any other attribute, so like name or anything, whichever will be the unique one, it will give you the X path with that. So directly you can just copy that value only. You need not to go like, if that will if any attribute is not unique, then only it will go for the traversing and writing the complete with the respect to the parent one.
No, I mean instead of xpath you can go for selector and all, right? So given any element selection, how will you determine
yes.
whether I should go for selector or xpath?
So yeah, so that's like we should know like whether you want to go with the selectors or xpath. It depends on the need, because sometimes attributes are not there. In that case, what we will do, we will be going for this. If we want to go with like if we know that in the DOM CSS are there and selectors are there, we can just select the selectors and you will get the selectors value from there.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, sure.
Okay, hello. If there is a unique dynamic ID, then what is the possibility of the ChroPath?
So currently it is talking to the DOM, which is the current DOM. It's not it can't, it's not that intelligent that it can think that this ID is the dynamic ID. So if any ID is already there, it will generate the relative XPath with the respect of that ID. It will not be thinking that this ID could be changed next time if you refresh the page.
That means it will not effective if there is a dynamic ID. If there is a dynamic ID, it will give the that particular ID based on that particular ID.
Yes, that's what, like the logic behind is that currently it used to talk to the current DOM. Like if as a human being, if I will be looking at the DOM and if I will find any ID, immediately I won't be able to know whether this is ID is dynamic or not until unless it's not my application. So yeah, currently it's not.
I have one question. If we have a lot of iframes in our DOM,
yes,
then can ChroPath identify the elements inside the iframe?
Yes. So currently iframe with the current ChroPath version is not supporting iframe.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, in the ChroPath 3.0, I have added the support that if any element is inside iframe, we'll get to know that this element is inside iframe, and we can write it manually, but yeah, in coming releases, I'm trying to add the support for iframe.
Okay. I read most of the manual XPaths using contains text.
Yes.
Partial text.
Yes, yes.
How can ChroPath solve that?
Yes, so it's there. If you have anything, let me show you. It's already there for contains text. So first, if any element will be having the text or any attribute, it will be generating on the basis of that. Like first of all, it will go for attribute, then it will go for the text, and we'll try both the combinations, and if that is not getting the unique, then it will go for the parent one and then the up level.
All right, this is Sam.
Hello.
Have a question.
Yes, sir.
We are developing a product which is quite similar to what you have shown here.
Yes.
So we have a record and play. It not only records the XPath, but it also translates that into a test case and executes it on the fly.
Okay.
But we don't have a window like what you have shown here.
Yes.
Wherein you can just select, copy, paste, right? We don't have that feature. But whatever the user does,
that
it translates that into a test case in a cloud-based tool. So my question here is this code available for everybody? Can we build on top of it? Is there a scope for collaboration?
Yes. So like sometime back I have open sourced it. I mean, put it on Git as public, but I was doing some code refactoring. So again, I have made it private. Very soon I will be like pushing it public.
Okay. And it will be available for
everybody
to.
It's in Chrome extension and Firepath extension. So Firefox extension. So it's like code is almost available there.
All right. Thank you.
So here you can see your question. So here you can see it's having the attribute as well as contains text. So it check for the attribute. If not, then it's go for the text.
Yeah. So we'll just chop these questions from now. Sanjay is going to be around.
Yeah.
And we just found two collaborators wanting to collaborate each other. This is why we come to conferences, meet people who are like-minded and work together. So you guys can meet again. And I would like to see what you together bring up next. So thanks a lot, Sanjay, for coming and talking about this.
You can write me any query, anyone, if any query has, you can write me here on Twitter.